Good evening. Welcome to another exciting program of the International Grapevine. This is your host, Wallenford Lee. Tonight on the Grapevine, we want to talk about Costa Rica today. Costa Rica happened to be one of the most interesting countries in the world. It is the only country in the world that doesn't have an army, a free country, an outstanding and beautiful place to live. We feel extremely happy to have our personal guest today, who's going to sit down and talk to us a little bit about Costa Rica. I'm talking about Mr. Ricardo Thompson, who's the former ambassador to Costa Rica in Trinidad and Tobago. Ricardo, welcome to our program.
Many thanks, Mr. Wallenford. It's a great privilege to be here with you today in this program. So I will be ready to do whatever you want me to do for you to get some insight of Costa Rica and for the people of the United States that will be listening to us.
Well, that's good to know. What are the things that I want to start with so that those who might not be familiar with our country understand? What is the approximately the population of Costa Rica right now?
It's around 5,300,000 people and inhabitants of Costa Rica.
And what type of structure, when we talk about the population, how is the structure more or less broken down as an example?
Well, you could talk it's a country most cosmopolitan, you could say, because you have people from all walks of life that come to Costa Rica. As you said it before, Costa Rica had abolished the army in 60 years ago, and that make Costa Rica a very beautiful place for people to come and enjoy our country. And so the type of government we have, the health system that we have, it's a very unique thing, different from a lot of countries in Latin America.
Well, it's a beautiful situation. One of the things that really surprises a lot of people is to understand that Costa Rica doesn't have an army. And I like the fact that you talk about how it was abolished and why it was done. And despite all of that, Costa Rica has never had an invasion or any type of problems, correct?
No, because we always been a peaceful country. And our money, let's call it our money, goes to education and goes to health. You would have a 5.7.6 of the money that is used in education, and also a great amount that is used to put in the public health. I'm talking about the gross domestic product.
That's very interesting. One of the things that we found amazing is to find out that in Costa Rica, Intel is there, Amazon is there, and a lot of American companies. Let's talk a little bit about the economic situation in Costa Rica. How is the economic situation right now in that country?
Well, it will be surprising for a lot of people, but Costa Rica is one of the most exciting places when it comes to talk about the economy regards to the other countries in Central America, because we do have a great scale of people that studies, people that go to university, and people well prepared in the country. And so the money, what comes from the economy, it will be put in the health system. As you may know, Costa Rica has a health system that all hospital that is in Costa Rica almost concern what you would call the Caja Costarricense de Seguro Social. So everybody is entitled to receive health service in Costa Rica. And the economy, well, with this, with the coronavirus, you will feel that it was a little bit. And we expect the coronas to go away pretty quick, because it will damage the economy, whether you want or not, it will damage the economy. But we are fighting with this. We are getting through with the people. We are prepared to receive people from outside. And to give them whatever it takes to make them feel at home.
That's good to know. That's good information. Let's talk a little bit, just an example of some of the American or foreign companies that are in Costa Rica, so the viewing audience can get a taste or a flavor who's there otherwise than Intel and Amazon. Who are some of the American companies or foreign companies that are there?
You have a lot of companies like Microsoft. You have in some of the companies that give you the implements for medicines, and you have had a great reception for the Intel, because when the President Jose Maria Figueres brought it to Costa Rica, it's because Costa Rica had an environment or an atmosphere that you know that you have no problem to set up a company in Costa Rica. So we started with Intel, and then we go on with a lot of different companies in the technological field.
So it's safe to say right now that Costa Rica economy is in good condition, would you say?
Well, we can say it is in good condition, but we have to watch out. Let's use that word, watch out, because with this thing of the coronavirus, it had hit us a little, and you have to reinstate several different system of to confront the things that is going to hit the country in the near future.
Good. We'll get into the coronavirus in a few minutes, but let's talk a little bit about what is the national debt right now. You have any idea?
Well, I cannot tell you the national debt because it's a little bit high, because we need to get a lot of loan. World Bank, the Central American Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and those is to continue building roads, building hospital, and building school. So the economy in that way is high. We cannot tell you, say, we don't not have a great debt. We have a great one, but we fighting to come through.
Well, we know for a fact that most Latino countries have a high debt. I think this is the first time Costa Rica have had such a large debt, but they are meeting their debt and they are paying their bills, which is a good thing. You talk a little bit about La Caja Costarricense de Seguro Social, which is one of the most powerful health service in all of America. My understanding is that a good part of the health system is somewhat free. Can you walk us through that a little bit about the health service that Costa Rica gives?
So let us put it this way. Costa Rican institution that was built in 1941, the 1st of November, is to give everybody a system of security and wages that you will go through there, and the health system to make it useful for everyone. It doesn't matter if you come from the United States, if you come from Nicaragua, if you come from elsewhere, if you have a problem in Costa Rica, you will be attended in the hospital without any extra charges. If you have money, well, you will have to pay for service.
Sure.
because you did not pay according to the people them that work in the country. But everybody that work in the country and can show your ID and is a citizen or a foreigner, as long as you're receiving a salary, you pay a part to the seguro, the government pay a part, and the entrepreneur people pay. So you will have three type of money coming in to fund the Caja. NICAH, which is the Costa Rican Social Security System. So there you go. And this institution some couple years ago took over the hospital, because you used to have hospital that was managed by the Ministry of Health. But right. All the hospital now are directly in contact with what the policy is in the Caja Costa Ricense del Seguro Social.
Very interesting indeed. We found it amazing that in terms that they will serve any and anyone who come into the country or any Costa Rican without asking them much question. When we get back on the international grapevine, we want to take the opportunity. We want to talk a little bit about the amount of foreigners that are into Costa Rica. And we want to talk a little bit when we get back on the grapevine on issues facing Costa Rica with a lot of people from Nicaragua coming over into the country. We'll be right back on the International Grapevine with Mr. Ricardo Thompson.
Vice President Campbell Barr, thank you so much for joining us on America's Now. You are the first female vice president of Afro descent in Costa Rica and in Latin America. Very significant accomplishment. What would you have to say about reaching that level of government?
Para mí es un tema muy importante. Significa un cambio cualitativo en términos de la participación política de las mujeres afrodescendientes en América Latina y el Caribe. Significa una construcción de sociedades más inclusivas, en donde las mujeres afrodescendientes, las mujeres de grupos que han sido históricamente más excluidos, tenemos la posibilidad de ocupar espacios de poder. Para mi país es un tema importante, sin embargo, quiero decir que mi carrera política en Costa Rica es una larga carrera política, pero creo que es una señal para la democracia de la región, para abrirle las puertas a más mujeres que están haciendo este esfuerzo de participación política y para que ya no seamos más representantes en los altos niveles por excepción. Así que es una puerta que se abre en la que espero vengan muchas otras mujeres por detrás.
And we're back here in the grapevine talking about one of the beautiful countries in the world. We're talking about Costa Rica. We want to take this moment to talk a little bit about the beautiful country that is Costa Rica and all of the things that are taking place. We are privileged today to have as a special guest on the program, Mr. Ricardo Thompson, who is a former ambassador of Costa Rica in Trinidad and Tobago. And he has been kind enough to be on our program to share certain things with us. He talked a little bit about the abolishment of the army in Costa Rica back in 1948. He talked a little bit about the Seguro Social, how it works and how it covers people from all walk of life, not only Costa Rican. He talked a little bit about the economy, which is very, very good in Costa Rica. Like any other things, it's going through a little ups and downs, but it's doing okay. They are not hurting. And now what we want to do is take this opportunity right now to talk about a certain amount of folks who cross the frontier and come into Costa Rica. Just like in the United States of America, each and every one of you that watch this program know that it's good to accept foreigners. But right now, Costa Rica is confronted with a serious problem with a certain amount of group of people who cross the frontier. Ricardo, can you talk to us a little bit about that? What effect and what kind of problem has that brought to the country? Or if it's not any problem, how are they dealing with that?
Well, it would be amazing for you to know that this country is well known by a lot of Central American people and elsewhere in the world. And it becomes something that you would say very nice for people to have a good taste of it. So, Costa Rica, you have a good health system, you have a good education system, you have no army, so you have a democracy without problems. You will have certain problems with the politicians and things like that, but that is normal because who is not on the power want to get there and who is there don't want to come off. But it's still not a problem because we have free election every 4 years, fixed election every 4 years. And when one win, you take over. And when one lose, they step down and no problem. The thing about people coming to this country, it because it gives you the opportunity to be free of a lot of things that would in other places would give you a lot of problems. So Nicaraguan comes here, why? You get good pay, you get if you working, you can go to the hospital, you can go to some basic health system and clinics that are in different communities, and you get full attendance, you get your medicine, you get everything, you don't have to pay. And a foreigners, let me make this clear to you, have the same amount of acceptance in getting everything as medicine as a Costa Rican. Once you're in Costa Rica and you're sick, you will get all the attendance that is necessary. Here we have transplant, heart transplant, we have liver transplant, and we name it. Such things don't happen in the rest of country like in Central America. And we have a kind of thing like for tourism, that you would call it plastic surgery for tourism, and eyes and heart problems, that it's better here in Costa Rica than the countries in Central America. And so people come to Costa Rica because you have a system which make you feel free, that you walk, you don't have no problem, that police is beating you and police is shooting you. And the people that come from Nicaragua, they find it very easy to come and work here because their money worth a lot. They take the money, they work here, and they send back money to their family in Nicaragua. Once they are in Costa Rica, they don't want to go back because they don't have no kind of persecution with government. Nobody's running you down, and if you don't accept this government, you have a problem. No, Costa Rica don't have that.
That's good to know, Ricardo, and I can't emphasize how important and interesting it is. I also know for a fact from an economic background that these type of things have a weight and a nation problem in the economy in the long run. But you brought up a very interesting point that some people are doing certain jobs that someone in Costa Rica don't want to do. This is some of the things that we go also here in the United States. But let's deviate from that. We'll get back to that down the road in a second interview. Can you tell us right now, who is the president of the nation, when he took place, and who is the vice president? My understanding is for the first time in I don't know how many moons, we have a black vice president in Latin America, and she happened to be Costa Rican. Can you talk to us about who is the president of Costa Rica right now?
Well, and who's the president... name is Carlos Alvarado Quesada. He took over the post 2 years ago, 8th of May, in 2018, and he will be there until 2022. I told you already, we have fixed election. The elections take place in February, and the one that win will take the seat in May that same year. For our community as Afro-Costa Rican and for black people, we have the first female black vice president in Costa Rica, whose name is Epsi Campbell Barr. And we are very conscious that this is something great for us, because no other country in Latin America can talk about something like this. And for your surprise, if you do not know, the 1st of May, we had the election for the president of Congress, and it came to be in the hands of a black man too. His name is Eduardo Cruikshank Smith. So we have two high ranking person in this country as black people.
Well, that's great news, obviously, because it shows the creativity, and also that the Costa Rican people or the society accept Afro Caribbeans that live in their nation, and that's a good thing. Tell me, Ricardo, the new government has done a good job, or it's too early to say?
Well, I tell you what, I don't think it's the best thing that happened to Costa Rica with this Carlos Alvarado, even though we have Afro-Costa Rican as vice president. But he has took some measures that is come to increase the taxes and the poor people, and some people is feeling
the weight
right now. And he has lately he said there will be no more wages in the near future. We don't know when, because since the economy is dropping through the coronavirus, and he has done certain things that make you wonder if it's the real person you want to be in power, or you pray for the next 2 years to finish right away. So,
well, Ricardo, just on those notes, unfortunately, we have run out of time, but I want to take this opportunity on behalf of the family of the Grapevine to thank you so much for being our special guest and for important all the important things that you talk about in Costa Rica. We hope to have you back on the program to have a part two so we can continue talking about infrastructure, Costa Rica, and all the good things. Again, thank you so much for being my guest, and I hope to and expect to have you back on the program soon.
Well, thank you, Mr. Wallingford.
Again, it's a pleasure. And again, this is Wallingford Lee saying goodnight for the family of the Grapevine, and hope that you have enjoyed this program about Costa Rica. Once again, thank you, and we hope to see you next week at the same time, at the same place. Good night.